I'm Josh Good, and I manage external relations for our Values and Capitalism Project, which is the host of today's and last night's summit. And this has been a really robust, I think, sort of thought-provoking and different than expected conversation today. And we're really grateful for you staying with it, and we have a real treat in store for you this evening. It's my pleasure to get to introduce, really, not all of them, but the three best-dressed PhDs in Washington, D.C. every once in a while, in our project, which does work with Christian colleges throughout the country advancing a moral case for free enterprise, we stumble upon a leader at a school who really gets it. And Greg Thornbury is one of those people. There are five or seven or nine that we've stumbled upon so far who are leading a university and really share our vision and values. And so it's a real pleasure to have him and the others that he'll be introducing to you with us this evening. Dr. Thornbury is president of King's College in New York City, right in the heart of Wall Street. He comes at this as a former professor of philosophy from the School of Theology, former dean and vice president of spiritual life at Union University. He spent his career in higher education. He's got a senior fellow at the Kairos Journal. He serves as theological editor for BibleMesh.com, an online curriculum platform for biblical literacy. He's written a book called Recovering Classic Evangelicalism, and he will be leading us through a conversation tonight with two of the best thinkers in the country in this space, in the area of human flourishing, work, suffering, faith, how they all connect and lead to a better life for more people. So Greg Thornbury, welcome to AEI, and please lead us through this evening's conversation.
Thank you very much, Josh. Thank you. Let me see if this text rings a bell. Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Happy are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Happy are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Happy are those who hunger and are persecuted for righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Now, when I was in my angsty teenage years, it was a sign of rebellion against my godly parents to sneak Bob Dylan, Beatles, and Rolling Stones albums into the house. This was pretty much the extent of my rebellion. Actually, it began with the Monkees, Eric. Eric and I are co-Monkees fans. We've actually formed a band called Super True, and so you have to come see us play in New York sometime. And I remember feeling especially rebellious when I heard a song by Bob Dylan called Up to Me, and here's one of the lines in it. "Well, we've heard the Sermon on the Mount, and we knew it was too complex. It didn't add up to anything more than the broken glass reflects. When you bite off more than you can chew, you have to pay the penalty. You look a little burned out, my friend. I thought it might be up to me." Now, as I went back to the Sermon on the Mount, something I'd heard before, and looked at what Jesus actually said, it does seem a little bit confusing to say, "Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are you when people persecuted you. Blessed are those who mourn." So I think we're all here tonight because I've noticed the creep of this, particularly in evangelical circles over sort of the last decade, maybe 15 years, of talk about the common good, human flourishing, and happiness and so forth. But what is happiness? Is it possible to even know? And in what ways might it be counterintuitive than what our, you know, sociopolitical, cultural backgrounds might have us to believe? So tonight what we're going to do is we're going to engage in a conversation about whether or not it's possible to define happiness, what my esteemed colleagues think about it, and we are going to get in the weeds on this, and then we're going to turn it over to you, because as I was saying to Arthur and Eric in Arthur's office a few minutes ago, I spoke in public for the first time when I was 14 years old. And my father got in my face and he said, "Son, there's two things you got to know about public speaking. One, the brain can only contain what the bottom can endure. And number two, if you can't strike oil in a half an hour or less, quit boring people." So you all have been sitting on your bottoms, and I know that the brain can only contain what the bottom can endure. So we're going to get in rather expeditious fashion, you guys hold me to this, to throw it open to the floor, and we'll have a conversation about this. Now let me introduce my co-panelists here. The good news is, I think we've assembled the right two guys to help guide us in a conversation on happiness. Okay, I think this is a faith-friendly crowd, so I can say, "And all God's people said..." Okay. To my left, we have Arthur Brooks, and I'm not going to insult your intelligence. I know you can read your program. And here is a man who definitely needs no introduction because this is his house. But I want to say this on a personal note. As I fan out across the country in the various places in which I find myself, and I'm looking to recruit college students to the King's College in New York City, a big part of what we're about is trying to re-enchant this generation with the animating ideals that made Western civilization great and America exceptional in particular. And time and time again, I find myself in speaking to students coming up with who are the touchstones for this generation about recapitalizing free enterprise. And Arthur Brooks is definitely that guy, because he's brought the moral dimension back into the conversation, where a lot of students, their primary introduction to capitalism is either some Hollywood movie in which that's the villain, or maybe if they're really precocious, they're reading Zizek or watching Zizek films. So Arthur, thank you so much for your role and presence in this generation.
Thank you.
And for your work on the pursuit of happiness and the road to freedom. To my right, I've known Eric Metaxas since 2003. And you no doubt know him as the author of the runaway bestseller, New York Times bestseller on Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Bonhoeffer, pastor, martyr, prophet, spy. By the way, you know, Eric seems to be surprised that he wrote a bestseller, genuinely surprised. But I understand now in many churches, they hand out Eric's Bonhoeffer book like they used to hand out Fleetwood Mac's Rumors album back in the 70s. Like, you get your suburban home, and here's your copy of Rumors. So Eric Metaxas, my introduction to him, and you can read the program, the founder and host of Socrates in the City, one of the amazing writers and minds of our generation. But I want to tell you, the first time I met Eric was in 2003. Friends of mine, Mano and Camille Kemporis, invited me to an early Socrates in the City event. David Aikman was speaking that night, but Eric was the host, and he opened up the evening with a 10-minute introduction of David Aikman that was side-splittingly funny. And when it was over, I don't honestly even remember anything else that happened that night except the jokes that Eric told in this bizarre, trippy introduction of this, you know, great journalist, David Aikman. So I went up to him afterwards and I said, "If Woody Allen had ever gotten born again, he would be you." And so that is my introduction of Eric Metaxas. So, yeah, that's totally appropriate. All right, gentlemen. Here we are. We find ourselves here on the horns of a definitional dilemma. Is it possible to define what happiness is? There are many definitions of this throughout history. There's Epicurus, there's the Aristotelian one. How are you guys going to help
us? That man over there has written about happiness, and yes. I think you must
you want to be the lead off. You want to define happiness for us?
No,
define it, or even act it out.
140 characters or less.
Yeah. Look, it's amazing how the definition of happiness has changed over the years. It was until relatively recently, happiness was not something you felt. Happiness was a good life well lived, according to Aristotle. And so the I could tell you by looking at your virtue whether or not you were a happy person. You could be drowning in clinical depression. But if you were living a good life well lived, by the standards of community virtue, as I saw it, I'd say, well, axiomatically, you're happy. The whole idea of people defining it for themselves, this is this crazy New Age American idea.
But to ask you that, I'm guessing that Aristotle and, you know, anybody previous to the last century didn't happiness is a modern concept. I cannot imagine that Aristotle was worried about being happy.
Well, personal happiness as we understand it here is a modern concept.
Right. And so isn't that what happiness is?
Well, happiness depends on, again, it depends on the historical context, but here's how it really entered the American vernacular. We take it for granted when you read the second paragraph of the Declaration of Independence, we're endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights, among them life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That wasn't the original text, actually. The Virginia Declaration of Rights, which was written 3 weeks earlier, was the basis for the Declaration of Independence. And it talked about life, liberty, and the ownership of property. It was really, really different.
John Locke.
Yeah, from John Locke and Thomas, which had deep moral implications. Thomas Jefferson substituted the pursuit of happiness for that. And later he was, and that was a really new idea, because basically what it was saying is that Americans are individuals with the human dignity to define happiness individually, and they have the God-given right to pursue the happiness that they have defined. Really ahistoric. Totally not a typical European kind of thinking. And when Thomas Jefferson was asked years later, in his twilight years, why did you write that? He said, simple. It was an expression of the American mind. And basically, that was the zeitgeist that was floating around in this crazy immigrant country. But really, it was a reflection of the American heart, because that's, at least in concept, why people came and still come today.
That's incorrect. But you made some good points, Arthur. No, it's interesting to me. I think I want to be the skunk at the garden party and say that I think the whole idea of happiness is stupid. And I mean that. I mean, when you think of the root of the word happiness, right? It comes. I mean, Shakespeare uses the word hap, H-A-P, and for something to happen.
Well, it means luck.
I was just going to say, really, right. What it means is luck. So how you doing? I'm happy, right? In other words, things are going my way is really what that means. To be happy is to have things go one's way. And we all know that that's very shallow. It's a very shallow concept. And to me, chasing happiness, it's a fool's errand. The idea that we can chase happiness, it's like living your life for vacation or retirement. When you get there, you know, it's like the dog that catches the car. What do you do when you catch it? They don't know. And, you know, people retire and die. It's the idea of chasing happiness seems fundamentally wrong to me. And I think that, and also, you know, not just wrong, but shallow. You know, we cannot be talking about happiness. I mean, I would say off the bat, we're talking about something. We have to be talking about something else. We long for meaning, right? And we know that even if I'm suffering, I can have joy in my suffering, but not happiness. Happiness is something else. So I think that, I don't know what word Aristotle would have used. He didn't
speak. Eudaimonia.
Gesundheit. I think that's correct. But I'm guessing that word is very
different. But it meant something very different, and we don't have a good English equivalent,
right.
I think, is what you're trying to say. But you did raise something here that I...
He wrecked the whole thing, so let's go to something else.
I know.
Yeah.
The
let's
train
talk
is
about
now,
human flourishing.
Where's the train right. most free, Eric?
Let's right. talk
where's
about
Where's the
pain
train
and
most
suffering.
Free? It's the train is most free on the tracks. Now we're uh-huh. into pain
right?
and suffering. But you did raise something yes. here that... let's go ahead and put the issue out in the open, and since we're all think, well, I can't speak for everyone, but many of us are thinking about Joan Rivers right now. I think one of
raise your hand if you were just thinking of Joan Rivers.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much. Okay,
and,
a couple people.
And if you raise your hand, get out.
Okay.
Because that's just wrong. Go ahead.
This is another cultural reference. You know, I have to say, we started off the evening with this. See, I'm a Catholic, and that's good, by the way. And you started with this obscure text that you referred to as the Sermon on the Mount. Where can you find this? Right. I'm going to call my priest because I think he probably knows. Is this a book?
It is widely available.
You were talking about Joan Rivers.
Joan Rivers, one of her best jokes was, people say that money is not the key to happiness. But I've always felt like if you had enough money, you could always buy a key. So I do think you raised this question about, pursuing happiness, which means the acquisition of more. Is this what, when you write about happiness, is this what you're talking about?
Well, no, and this is actually, it raises an interesting point, because I've been thinking a lot about unhappiness lately as opposed to happiness, and when you find the reaction that people actually have to unhappiness, which is way more tangible, it turns out that unhappiness is processed in a different part of the brain than happiness. Unhappiness is on the right half of the prefrontal cortex, and happiness is processed on the left half of the prefrontal cortex. And so you find that when one is lit up, the other is not. And people are a lot more interested in avoiding unhappiness than they are in finding happiness, no matter what that means. People are desperate to mm-hmm. to avoid unhappiness. This is something that theologians have taken up a lot more than finding happiness. Aquinas talks about this a lot. St. Thomas Aquinas says, he talks a lot about the reason that people are not happy is because they're finding substitutes for God. He says, the quest of a man's life when he's not enlightened is always looking for the substitutes for God. And he defines the substitutes for God: money, power, pleasure, honor. And by honor, he doesn't mean an honorable soldier, he means fame. Money, power, pleasure, honor. These are the substitutes for God. Systematically, we look for these things. And the great paradox of life is, why do we look actively for the substitutes for God, trying to find happiness and ultimately finding misery, and do it again and again and again? This is one of the great unanswered questions of our lives.
Well, I would say it's because that's what the culture keeps pushing, this idea that, I mean, it's a fundamentally temporary thing. And anybody knows that if you're running after something that you will inevitably at some point lose, you're an idiot. I mean, we're supposed to, we're supposed to do things that have some permanence. Building character is something that, no matter where you are on the how I feel today scale, if you're building character, you're progressing somehow in your soul, in life. Happiness is something that we chase after and then it goes away. And it is like being lucky. Like, how are you doing today? Well, today I'm lucky. I had a good day. This happened, that happened. Those things are independent of us. And so the temporary quality of it, bless you, it's where we are in the culture. The culture, it's the same thing with love, right? Like, we know, those of us who are married, that every day you feel differently toward your spouse. You can love your spouse exactly the same every day, but that feeling of, how do I feel today? My wife might not be lovable today, and tomorrow she might be lovable. I might be in the mood to be loving one day and not be in the mood to loving, but God commands us to love. It's a different thing. The world is chasing after this feeling of love. And so what happens, of course, is you fall in and out of love. That's where the culture is, and that's where we get this idea. I shouldn't say it's where we get this idea, but it's the same idea with happiness. But they, oddly enough, are pushed away from thinking about the logical, the logical conclusion that if something you're running after something that it won't be forever. We're just living in a culture right now that doesn't want to talk about that or think about that.
Is that new?
I would say in a way it's new. I think that we have as much original sin today as we did at any time in history. Except 1968, there was a little more that year. But the thing is that cultures focus on different things, and I think our culture really we're in this bubble of prosperity. I mean, just imagine, 300 years ago, if you had 10 kids, three of them died. These things have changed, and so we have the luxury now to fool ourselves, I think, more effectively. And I do think that we are different in that. We don't focus on character as much. We don't focus on honor in the good sense, duty, and the long-term values and virtues. We focus less on that in the culture, and it's more about, are you happy? Hmm. And I have to say, I don't want my daughter to be happy. I don't care whether she's happy. I care whether she's good. I care whether her life has meaning. I care whether she has found something beyond herself. But that's what I care about. The idea is I just want my kids to be happy. I think it's a destructive idea.
So where does this, let's back out of this then, and Arthur, help us to understand then, where does this come from? I mean, what are the origins for taking, putting an emotional state or some sort of temporary psychological state at the center of this discussion of happiness, when the ancients clearly would have defined this in a different way, whether it be Aristotle or Aquinas or Epicurus or John Locke or Leibniz or whoever? How did this happen to us? I mean, how did we get here? Fix this.
So not all of the ancients agreed with this idea of character and meaning. I mean, there were a lot of ancients who were hedonists. And if you go back, the culture in biblical times was a god-awful mess. I mean, right now in the Catholic lectionary, every day, right now we're going through the first letter of Paul the Corinthians. And, he's warning them that woe be unto the fornicators and the boy prostitutes. Ay, 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 the stuff that he's talking about. I mean, this is like really modern, gross stuff that's going on. That was going on there too. I mean, the biggest problem they had was these that Paul talks about are these temples where people would go and pay for sex with prostitutes in the temples, in these pagan temples. I mean,
as a part of worship.
Yeah, as a part of worship.
Was there a lot of velour in these temples?
Oh man. So I mean, there's nothing new under the sun. Is my point. And on a careful reading of these things, you find that people are looking for the substitutes for God then too. Right? It's just human.
Yeah.
Money, power, pleasure,
yeah.
Honor. There's a formula. This kind of follows a formula of these substitutes for God, of this materialism, of looking for these idols. And it's basically a formula that Peter Kreeft, great scholar, who writes about Aquinas a lot. He says that the basic formula for the worldly people is use people, love things, worship yourself. That's it. And that's what Hollywood tells us to do. And that's what your college professors, except you, tell us to do. That's what Madison Avenue tells us to do, is use people, love things, and worship yourself. The key thing then is, why do people want to do that, and how can we invert that to render it virtuous? And in so doing, find our own formula that really does lead us to what we seek, which of course is to worship God, love people, and only use things.
But I would think that if we were surrounded by, your sort of typical college crowd, university students, someone in there would say, well, the reason why there's this greed, the reason why we use people is because of our economic system. It's built on taking from others, and rich people aggrandizing themselves, and this sort of thing. So what do you say to that, Arthur? I mean, how does economics play into this?
It doesn't. Anybody who was behind the Iron Curtain before the fall saw the worst kind of selfishness and venality that you could have possibly seen. The truth is that people will manipulate any system for their own rent-seeking and selfishness. The best possible system for you as a very clever, selfish rent-seeker who hates the other humans is socialism, bar none. It's the best, because you can twist that really well. You'll be punished, typically, in a true system of free enterprise, because it's not very efficient for somebody to get everything in exchange for nothing. Now, I'm not saying that things are going to turn out okay. The point that I'm trying to make is that no matter what the economic system, it has to be predicated on morality. It has to be predicated on morality. Now, it turns out that the person who made that point most clearly was Adam Smith, who wrote The Wealth of Nations, the canonical text that defined free market economics that people quote all the time. His most important book was written 17 years earlier, in 1759, and it was The Theory of Moral Sentiments, where he talked about the predicates to free markets actually being a properly ordered moral society, where people treated each other with decency and honesty, and all of these homely virtues that we talk about here. He says you can't have markets, you can't have any sort of economic exchange system that works properly unless you start it with human morality. That's what we forget, and that's what we don't want to talk about.
Correct.
Thank you.
Now we finally found something you can agree with.
That's right.
Excellent. Well, it is interesting. If you want to be happy, you should ignore suffering and ignore the suffering of other people if you want to be happy, right? If you want to be good, you need to look at those things and think, what can I do to help? I think that clearly in the last, let's say, 40 or so years, the idea of talking about morality, it's fallen out of favor. Let's face it, it's become reduced to, you're a moralist, you're a prude, you're a prig, we don't want to talk about that. It's the 60s cliches, basically, that as soon as we talk about morality, people tune out, they don't get it. And of course, that's a problem, because we understand that, both democracy and capitalism are neutral, right? Without morality, they can be used by the devil for evil ends. We need to, I want all my libertarian friends to understand that.
They don't.
I wish George W. Bush had understood that democracy is very fragile and it can't be handled by everybody, just because ultimately we'd want them to handle it. They might not be ready. That in order for these two things, these great things to work, you need morality. You need people who are willing to not just vote to line their pocketbooks. You need people who understand that the free market can crush people, that I want to have a bit. If I have a business, I want it to be a moral business. I don't want it to be just about beating the next guy or getting the most money. Those ideas, I think, are simply not talked about very much these days. Somebody just wrote something, I can't remember, about Hobby Lobby, the idea of them being wanting to be a moral company somehow. We don't really have very much of that. I don't know when that fell out of favor.
Which was completely not understood.
That's right.
By the secular media. I mean, they had no idea what that meant. In the light of the Hobby Lobby decision. But Arthur, I want to come back to you on this, because you've written extensively on the moral case for free enterprise. So if we're talking about declining interest in morality and in character, how do we get back to that? I mean, how do we reinstill an interest in character and moral development in this kind of toxic, acerbic environment?
The first thing to remember, particularly as we talk to our friends who are secular but do care about poor people, do care about people who are vulnerable, is that the most important way, as an empirical matter, the most important way that rich people steal from poor people today is by not talking about values. You know, that's a fact. If you read my colleague Charles Murray's work, Coming Apart, it's a big bestseller he wrote in 2012, what he showed was that we rob the poor when we don't share our secrets to success. And our secrets to success are faith, family, community, and work. Those are the secrets to success of people in the top 10% of the income distribution. Incidentally, those are the secrets to a good life. a life that's actually full of meaning. And what do you find most lacking in the bottom 20% of the income distribution? Faith, family, community, and work. See, we don't even know what's going on with real poor people. Say, yeah, well, poor people, they're actually real religious. Wrong.
Yeah,
you find that the bottom 20% of the income distribution is the least religious part of the income distribution. Faith, family, community, and work are decimated by bad public policy and rotten culture, and most importantly, by our unwillingness to share our secrets to success. When we talk about being our brother's keeper, when we talk about being proper stewards of the blessings and the bounties of this great country, that's not just about money. That's about all of the things that are of value, all of the treasures that we enjoy so abundantly. The beginning of solving this problem is not being a Puritan, it's being a good Samaritan. And that means talking about the things that make our lives good.
But how do we share these things, right? I mean, I don't know too many poor and educated people who are reading Charles Murray's books. And that's the problem, in a way, that, you know, on some level we talk amongst ourselves. These things have to be put out into the media, the culture, and I think conservatives are particularly bad at that. There's no doubt about it. We're terrible at it. And the poor have suffered because we're bad at that. Think of the movies of Frank Capra. Think of the movies of the past, not just Capra. They extolled these things. Not every single movie, but many of them, I would say most of them, extolled eternal verities. That is not happening, and I really think that is the problem. We can write all the books we like. It's got to go beyond that. Those books have to influence media executives, movie executives, TV executives. Otherwise,
right.
These ideas aren't out there.
Yeah, no, I think that's right. But the popular culture is largely influenced by the private discourse in a country. The leading indicator of what's going to get into movies and television and music is what people are actually talking about, what people are interested in. I think that we have become afraid to actually talk about these things as private individuals. I think we're afraid to talk about virtue.
But isn't that because
we're cowed from this?
I would flip it, and I would say that it is, people talk about what movies and TV and music. I mean, it's hard in this day and age. 50 years ago, it wasn't the case. But in this day and age, it's hard to avoid that. The cultural conversation is beyond us. It's out there. It's on screens. And it feeds what we talk about. And these things aren't what are being talked about. And so in our private conversations, we're talking about them less because of that.
It's a bit of a chicken and the egg problem, isn't it?
No.
I mean, what both of you are saying is true. I do have the solution to this. I think you need a television talk show, Eric, that people can laugh at. But
Virtue Today with Eric Metaxas.
Serious. No, I want to raise something in that connection. You're very good friends with Dick Cavett.
Yeah.
And I remember being struck by a study that I saw a couple of years ago about the millennials, that whereas for our generation, the thing that we identified with were the people who spoke for us were the musicians. So Bob Dylan, U2, et cetera, Neil Young. For this generation, it's the comedians. For them, the key is what makes me laugh. Now, it seems to me that there's been, to go on to your point, to build on your point, there's been a sea change in a generation between what comedy represented, you know, during the 50s and 60s in the era of George Gobel and Imogene Coca and, you know, and Dick Cavett. And there was a different kind of discourse from what we see, you know, today in terms of comedy. Do you care to comment on that, on how that's change, what we laugh at has changed in the cultural conversation?
I wish I did. No, I do. I was kidding.
Oh, great.
I do. I do want to comment on that. I think it's about, you know, who are the, really for me, it's who are the truth tellers, right? It's like the court jester. You know, who are the truth tellers? And there's something, if you think about the 60s and the 70s, somehow it was a more innocent era, and so they were the troubadours. They were putting forth ideas that were not so much acerbic. Sometimes they were a little bit, but as the culture, you know, after Watergate and Vietnam, as we've turned more cynical, more acerbic, I think we now do look to the comedians to be the truth tellers. We know we're going to get it straight from them. And for me, it's, yes, I think that humor, to some extent, irony, it's the lingua franca. If you can't communicate in that, you're not communicating. And I would say for sure, conservatives, people talking about virtues, people who are talking about faith, are not typically communicating in that lingua franca. It's not happening. And so that's a very bad thing.
Conservatives are not very funny.
Except
for Eric. There's obviously some exceptions. I mean, our colleague Jonah Goldberg here at AEI is hysterically funny. But, I mean, come on. There's a reason there's not a conservative John Stewart, right? Now, what's the difference between the conservative and typical liberal sense of humor and mindset? There's actually a little bit of work that's been done on this. What you find is that liberals are more sarcastic and ironic than conservatives
right?
And that's partly generational, but it's partly ideological. Why? And we were talking a little bit earlier about, there's all this research about the difference in liberal and conservative morality. What you find is that there's a lot that conservatives and liberals have in common. I mean, they have in common this ideas of compassion and not egalitarianism, but a sense of fairness, even though they define it differently. But what liberals don't actually think is moral at all, that conservatives typically do, is respect for authority, loyalty to team or country, and a sense of purity. Look, if you don't have any sense of authority, loyalty, or purity, you're going to be sarcastic and ironic all day long. Nothing is sacred. So, and that's basically what's going
on. Well, I mean, that's putting it nicely. You're going to ultimately be bitter and nihilistic,
like
aren't
John
you?
Stewart.
Well, but, I wouldn't go so far as to
look,
say
I've been
that
on the show, have you?
Not intentionally, no.
So, I'm bitter.
Not intentionally.
I was featured in a clip mocking people like me.
Oh, that's nice.
So really, I wasn't
that's
on the
nice.
Show.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think that the issue is that you become nihilistic if you feel like all authority is bad, right? I mean, that term to me, it's the epitaph of this last generation: question authority. It doesn't mean question authority to see if the authority is legitimate. It means question the very idea of authority.
Sure.
All authority is by definition legitimate. Every priest is a child rapist. Every sprinter, every slugger got there with steroids. That kind of cynicism is toxic. It is also a lie, right? Let's say it's
sexual purity,
terrible
is stupid,
lie.
Loyalty is stupid, and authority is stupid.
Yeah, so if you believe
that,
what do you have
premise,
left?
You got nothing. You have absolutely
right.
nothing.
Right, so you just kind of groove on the
rubble. I want to push back on this a little bit, though, because I would say, in my experience, I find that the most profound moral conversations that I see generated are when, let's get off of John Stewart, we can be have different opinions about him, but what John Oliver's new program is kind of astonishing. I mean, his opening monologues are 12 to 14 minute set pieces, and it's a sustained argument about something. And very often, there is some kind of moral issue that is at stake, that, whether he's talking about net neutrality or the FIFA World Cup or what, and he's generating a lot of conversation about what is right and what is wrong. So I do think that there's an appetite out there for millennials. I agree with Eric that I just don't think we find people on our side that can make those arguments in a way that would cause people to tune in to pick up and follow the argument. And I think you use the analogy of having an army but no air force. No air.
Well, yeah, it's like we have we kind of wonder why we're. I mean, I think it's why we lost this last election. Things have changed to the extent now that, well, I don't mean to divide what I'm saying. Basically, right. So I say it's about the culture, okay? Christians figured out we need to get involved in politics. Great, good, exactly. But if you put all your eggs in that basket, you can't win. Because the TV programs, the sitcoms, the talk shows, those things set the tone of the conversation. Those things set the conversation. And so, you can have an evangelical conservative in the White House, but what about the magazine rack at the grocery store. What is reflected there? What are those values? We have not really tried to affect that kind of thing. And as far as I'm concerned, that affects how people think and it affects how people vote. And we have been out of that game forever, pretty much. And I think that it is reflected at the polls. I think in the last election, that's what happened. I thought that if you have a steady diet of 40 years of a certain kind of thinking, it can touch just enough people so that a bad president in a bad economy would still get reelected, and that's what I think happened.
You know, I see a lot of very distinguished people in the audience here, so let's throw it open to you and see what questions you have for Arthur and for Eric on this issue of what constitutes happiness. And Josh, what would be the mechanism here? We have
yes. Okay, and great. By the way, this is only for the distinguished people.
Right. Everyone here is distinguished, or you wouldn't be here. Yes, we've got a question over here.
So I was a pastor for 30 years, and when people in my congregation would say, "I just want to be happy," what they meant was, "I just want the war to calm down. I just want to be content. I want to have some peace." They weren't expecting much more than that. What would you say about that? Is that happiness at a whole different wavelength?
It's unhappiness. When people say, "I just want to be happy," what they're saying is, "I just want to stop being so unhappy."
Yeah.
That's what's going on. I mean, neurologically, as I mentioned earlier, these are different phenomena. And this is the part of their brain that's stimulating their unhappiness, their depression, their misery, their lack of contentment, their complete absence of well-being. That's what they want to go away. Because they don't know what it means to be happy, but they do know what it means to be unhappy, and they're feeling it right now. Anytime somebody says, "I want to be happy, I just want to be happy," they're saying, "Help me stop being so unhappy." Yeah. And I think in a very real way, our job as stewards of some Christian truth is to give somebody what they really want as opposed to the substitutes for God. Because right. if they keep looking for the substitutes for God, they're going to keep saying, "Just make me happy," by which they mean, "Please help me to get some relief from this unhappiness." Correct?
Correct.
Thank you.
Anything you want to add to that, Eric?
No, not really. No, that's good.
Okay, we've got one here, and then got one back here is the next question. So, okay, great. Yep.
Good evening. My name is Jose Ortiz, and I belong to the Christian Action Group of the Dominican Republic, and I'm the speaker for the Evangelical Dialogue Table of my country, which gathers the 40 evangelical councils and churches of my country. I have a question to Mr. Metaxas, just to inform you, Mr. Metaxas, that your book, Bonhoeffer, has been translated to Spanish and is number one in Christian bookstores in my country, and is very well read, and we have been able to know the life and legacy of Dietrich Bonhoeffer through your writing. My question to you, Mr. Metaxas, is about what you said, that we don't do anything if we win elections, but we don't change the culture. Recently in my country, Miley Cyrus was scheduled to present a concert this Saturday, and the government with the power of the law canceled the concert, and she won't be able to perform. We Christians are happy for that, but the liberal press criticized the government in a very virulent way, and the liberal groups are criticizing us because we influenced the government to adopt that decision. And we are being labeled as haters, bigotries, reactionaries, people from the caves. How can we react against that? Do you think that we need to keep pushing for prohibitions for the cleanness of the media and don't allow those artists to come to our countries to influence in a very bad way our children and our people?
I guess I would want to say selfishly that I hope Miley Cyrus stays in your country and continues not to be able to perform there. That would be the best of all possible worlds. I think this is very complicated, right? Because, you know, we're talking about censorship. And I think, look, in terms of how you all should react to it, laugh and praise Jesus. That's how you should react, because you're doing good. So who cares what the liberal, well, who cares what anyone thinks ultimately? I mean, unless they have real arguments, unless this is, you know, some kind of a fascist state. But I think that, you know, there's a role for government, and I think that, we live in a culture where for the last 40 years, all we do is talk about how, you know, censorship is a bad thing, or how talking about these things is oppressive. We never talk about how in the past we never talk about how that can also be a good thing, and let's find the balance. We don't talk about that. Right now, we have an attitude that anytime anybody raises an issue based on morality and says we don't want this in our community, that they're prudes or they're repressive or they're, you know, advocating censorship. Most people, of course, let's face it, unfortunately, don't even know the definition of censorship. They don't know what that means. They don't understand that, you know, if nobody buys your stupid album, that's not censorship, right? but they don't really understand these things. And again, the culture is not helping to educate them about that. In the United States of America, what deeply grieves me is that we have at least a generation that doesn't understand what it is to be an American, and these issues of freedom, censorship, all of these things, we really don't understand them. And if you don't understand them, you cease to be America. I mean, America is, we're an idea, and if we don't understand these ideas, what's the difference between oppressive censorship and a healthy kind of market freedom? And what these are things, we need to be talking about these things. But whenever, typically, as I say, in the last 40 years, liberals or the media are critical, it tends to be unthinking. It doesn't have the merit. I mean, there was a day when that case needed to be made, let's say. But I think we're on the opposite end of the, you know, the field at this point. So anyway, I've already said more than I know.
That's pretty good for what, something you don't know. Impressive.
We have a question down here in the front. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Melissa Ortiz. And Eric, I'm going to address this to you and to Arthur. I just want to start out by saying, if I want to choose to be unhappy, all I need to do is navigate the metro system during rush hour, and I am unhappy for a good long time. I have learned that happiness is a choice, but that joy is something even better. And I know that for me personally, and I would like to hear the two of you and the three of you talk about the difference between joy and happiness, because there is a distinct difference.
Let's start with you, Eric, and then.
Well, I mean, I think I said it at some point. You know, I can rejoice in the Lord always. I'm commanded to rejoice in the Lord always. So theoretically, I can rejoice in all circumstances. God doesn't ask me to do something that I can't do. That's a whole different thing from guaranteeing happy circumstances. And so that's why the whole idea of happiness, it's one of these, it's the cliche of our era. It's part of the vast array of cliches of our era. And I think it's about joy. It's
What's
happiness
joy?
Is
What's
not-
joy, Eric?
I don't know. We're gonna cover that in the next panel.
that's right.
Yeah, that's a good question. What's energy?
Yeah.
I don't know that either.
Any physicists? C.S. Lewis talks about joy. I mean, one of the most common Christian concepts. So what does it mean?
Actually, when Lewis talks about it, in all seriousness, I think he's talking about something slightly different. So I don't want to complicate it in my own mind by thinking of his definition of joy. But joy, I mean, in Scripture, when it says rejoice in the Lord always, it means to it really is to focus on what is true. I mean, to look to God, right, in the midst of things. Whatsoever things are good, whatsoever things are noble, to rejoice, to have a heart of gratitude, to see what is real in the midst of all the lies and confusion and smoke and mirrors and distortions of this world, to see God and the things that emanate from God, to see those things, and that is a moral choice. It's not what I see naturally with my fallen nature. I will not see those things unless I make some kind of an effort, unless I open myself to the Holy Spirit leading me to see what is rather than what seems to be.
You know, there's an important distinction, I think, that you're making between deciding and things spontaneously falling in your lap. St. Paul talks about the theological virtues, and the theological virtues of faith, hope, and love. Now, there's a tendency for Christians to say, well, these are the theological virtues, and I guess I'm pretty rotten if I'm not experiencing these virtues, faith, hope, and love, right? Well, it turns out these are gifts. The choice is faithfulness, hopefulness, and being a loving person. Those are choices. Everything else is just what you feel. And what you feel is based on kind of what you're digesting and whether or not you've been in the metro, right? So make the choice and then let the circumstances and God do the rest. Isn't that what we're supposed to do? Isn't that the difference between joy and happiness ultimately?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we had one here in the center and then one here. Greg Pittman, an alumnus of the King's College in New York City. I'm not playing favorites. He just had his hand up quicker.
But
how typical of a King student to have his hand up quicker.
They're eager beavers.
I was in Peter Kreef's class. You had to have a fast hand there.
Okay. What's your question?
So we know that we need to change the conversation because we're currently in the wrong conversation. But how practically do we do that in the modern age? Because there's a lot of what I would call technological apathy, where people will make blatant statements but hide behind a Twitter feed. And there's no, the conversations are moving from places like this to a Twitter handle or a Facebook page. So how do we change the conversation practically and keep it on a common ground?
How do we change the conversation in kind of in light of the infoglut culture? I think that's a good question, the apathy that comes from being in our infoglut society. How do you overcome apathy?
No, it's there's a tendency to look at institutions and markets. And I'm an economist, so I look at institutions and markets all the time. But the truth of the matter is that culture is a personal, it starts at the micro level, and it's a personal phenomenon. If you really want to change culture, change yourself and act differently. That's really all you can do. I mean, you can try to spread this out by starting new institutions and trying to, you know, start a Christian television station or something that actually spreads proper values on a mass scale. But the one thing that everybody can do is to make magnetic a particular set of values that we exhibit as individuals. This is how social movements actually happen. But social movements have vehicles that happen down along the way, but social movements start with a kind of a magnetism that draws people to individual characteristics and values, typically. Right? And you know, if you look at what was going on in the year 80, right? It wasn't St. Paul wasn't writing to the Ephesians because he wanted them to be better door knockers, just better door knockers to convert more pagans. What he was talking to them about was being actually at the individual level better Christians and so magnetize themselves and draw the pagans to them ineluctably. This is almost kind of a personal law of physics. If you are what you say you are, if you are what you want to be, people will be drawn to you. To start the culture on the change that we want it to be, we, number one, have to stop being part of that culture, being part of the culture we don't like, or at least stop acting as if we were members of that culture, and start drawing people to us because of the virtue that we actually can exhibit and the love that we actually show in reaction to that culture.
The only thing I would add to that is that while that is true and very important, and if you hadn't said it, I would have said it because it's key. But the thing is, when you talk about influencing the people you know, around yourself, you realize that ideally, if you are magnetic and are evincing these values and are selling something wonderful, you want to get it out to more people. That's when you start talking about distribution, right? You know, you can make a wonderful film, but you need distribution. And I think that what I think folks like us need to do is try to push these conversations into the public square more. I mean, I think of the conversation we've had just now. I flip around on the TV increasingly less, but do I ever stumble on conversations like this? Why don't I? If there's an appetite for it, if the market works, the invisible hand of the market works, well, we know that it doesn't necessarily work. It's a little more complicated, right? And basically, I think that we have to try to get, I mean, I just wonder if this conversation were on PBS out there, how many people that have never heard of any of us who are maybe not self-identifying as conservatives or evangelicals would nonetheless be fascinated and say, you know, I've been thinking about that. Nobody ever talks about that. And I thought maybe I was the only one who ever thought about that.
Right.
But this emboldens me to talk about it because I see people modeling that.
Yeah.
I think that, I don't know what AEI does and I don't know what that camera leads to on the other side, but I think that these kinds of conversations—
It's totally fake.
I think that these kinds of conversations need to get out there. That's what I've tried to do with my Socrates in the City events. I think that it's crucial to get these kinds of conversations out there somehow so that they will find an audience. Because then I think, of course, that audience will ask for more. But I think there's a huge hunger for things like this, that people want to talk about this.
I agree. And, you know, let me put a slightly different spin on that as well. How much is each one of you an infiltrator? You ever ask yourself that? You know, or are you really only around people like you? Are you an infiltrator? Are you writing for the liberal paper? Are you living in New York City or Los Angeles? Are you hanging out with people who are secular? I mean, is your witness basically to people who have already been witnessed to? Or are you going deep undercover? Because that's the key, isn't it? I mean, isn't it the key to be a witness to people who need the witness? It's very hard to do that. It's actually not that fun. But we have the strategy, you know, we talk about the morality of the free enterprise system here all the time. Who needs that? Persuadable people need that. How are they going to get it? Because they're going to witness you confronting with love people who are hostile to that idea.
Right.
I tell you what people are going to be impressed by. They can see Eric Metaxas being a really nice guy saying these things and being just beat up by Bill Maher. Right? They're going to say, you know, I saw this conservative on Bill Maher, and I'm not a conservative or anything, but he seemed like a really nice guy. That's infiltration. Think about all the opportunities we have to do that. It's just amazing. And we pass them up. Instead, you know, turn to Fox News, make sure you hang out with only people from your congregation.
Yeah.
Right? Live in a place where everybody's a Republican. Huh. Maybe that's not the way.
Maybe it is. just kidding. No, you're exactly right. But that really highlights my point, is that we've got to get this, you know, off of the AEI website and out there so that people who don't know what they think will say, well, that is interesting. Who is that? Oh, he's conservative. Interesting. We're not out there very effectively. And I think that, to me, it's sort of the same thing. We've got to do it on both levels.
Yeah. Well, we began tonight with the Sermon on the Mount. We'll close with the Sermon on the Mount. What credit is to you, my brothers, if you do good to those who bless you and you are friends with those who are friends with you? But I say, love your enemies. Bless and do not curse. And we want to be a blessing. And it's been a blessing for us to be here with you tonight. I've been told by our host, Josh Good, that Eric Metaxas will turn into a pumpkin momentarily if we do not cease and desist. So thank you very much for coming tonight. It's been all joy. And thank you. And we'll turn it back over to
thank
Josh.
You.
Before we thank our full panel and dismiss you to dinner and plan how that's going to work,
just want to say one quick thing on this, and that is that you know, this is a gathering of leaders, and we talked about that earlier today. This is a gathering of leaders who are allowed to be who we are allowed to be evangelical leaders, and you've heard that come out throughout the course of the day. You heard Steve Sutherland say last night how shaped he has been by Arthur's thinking, and that is true of a lot of people on the Hill. It's also the case, although it's on our website, that we're getting out there more than ever, and that this is not your father's AEI, and that's a result of Arthur Brooks' leadership. And I do think it's worth naming that if you've enjoyed today, and if you want to be part of the team that infiltrates back home and take some of this with you, we actually really do have not only the Kern Family Foundation to thank for that, but Arthur Brooks. So with that, I'd like to thank so much this evening's panel.
Thank you, John.